Bit better, but not so good this morning. I thought it would be good
Colin.
To
show.
Oh, come on, sorry. So
I
used to wear it.
You.
Okay, sorry about that. It's good to see you all. We welcome all those online, and perhaps some will be listening to the DVD later, so we welcome you too later on today. Shall we just commend our meeting into God's hands? Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord, that we can meet in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ this morning. We thank you that we can meet freely and openly. We can declare our praises to our mighty God who reigns in the heavens, the eternal one, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. We thank you for the Lord Jesus, that in him we have faith, trust. We thank you for the cross of Calvary. We thank you that that's where our burdens are lifted. Lord Jesus, just bless us this morning, we pray. We do pray for any who are unwell that you will come alongside them. Be a strength to them. And may we give praise, honour and glory in all that we do, that we might uplift Jesus. Jesus is King. We praise his name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
It's good to see you all, as I said earlier. And I thought this morning, you know, we support a number of missions in different places all over the world. And I was going through YouTube looking for some groups from abroad who sing. And our first one we're going to see online is from a group in India. It's called Voice of Eden. They're going to sing Burdens Are Lifted at Calvary. So if you could put that on, please. Through Solomon, we support the work in India that he does particularly, and the contacts he has there. So it's good to remind us of that. I want us to, a couple of verses I'd like to share with you from the book of Joshua, chapter 1. It says, and as we begin to think about the end of this year and the new year we move into, It says, be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the law my servant Moses gave you. Do not turn from it to the right or to the left, that you may be successful wherever you go. Keep this book of the law always on your lips. Meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. Some lovely encouraging words there. That we must keep focused. You know, focusing is very important. Daniel was telling me that he went down to the Kelshot Activity Centre and he had a go with a rifle there on shooting. And I think he was the most successful one in the class with five right in the middle, each four shots, bang, 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 right in the middle. So if we get any problems, we know to give the firearm to, don't we? But, you know, to be focused, to keep your eye focused is so important, isn't it? I was helping my young son John yesterday. I say young son, he's getting on now. And we were putting in a roof and we were cutting some, it's tongue and groove boarding. And the first one he cut, I said, John, it's 6 inches too short. No, Dad, it can't be. I said, it is, it is. He said, well, try the second one. The second one was spot on. So I don't know how we ended up by doing that, but anyhow. He lost his focus for a minute, you see, and we end up with problems. But here, God is speaking to Joshua, and he said, you're taking over. Focus, focus. Keep my law. Don't move from the right or to the left, and I will be with you and bless you. And as we think of this time in which we're going through, these difficult times, let us focus to be strong and courageous, for God is with us. God is with us. I'm going to lead us in some prayers now. And as I've been thinking about the people we support through our giving here in Marchwood, you know, we can't pray for every one of them in Sunday morning, but I'm just going to list the contacts that they have to where we give. We pray for the Jewish people, don't we? We pray for India, we've seen Pakistan. We support Nepal, Central Asia, South Sudan, Kenya, the Lebanon, Burkina Faso, the water project. We support the teaching material that goes worldwide. We support two local rest homes, and they're still fine, and hoping that we will return to the ministry there when things improve. We support that home in Bournemouth for people with learning difficulties. We support SASRA, the street pastors. We support a work in the universities, work among sailors, work in the open air. What a large range we can support and help as they proclaim God's service. Shall we now pray? I'm going to lead some prayers, okay? And we're just going to have a prayer time for a little while. Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord, that we can come in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we are reminded of the various works that we support here in Marchwood. We thank you for those who work amongst the Jewish people and pray you'll bless them and help them as they seek to take the Christian message to them. We pray for the contacts we have through India. And Lord, we pray, Lord Jesus, that you would bless, guide and direct that work, that ministry amongst your people there. We think of Pakistan, Nepal, Central Asia and South Sudan. And again, Lord, we pray for the contacts we have in those countries, perhaps indirectly, but Lord, we pray for the people there. We think of particularly the Brick people in Pakistan, that you will be with them and bless them. We pray for Nepal, Lord. We pray for those supporting the Christians there at this time, because they're finding it quite difficult with the coronavirus. We pray for the contacts we have in Central Asia, that we've been able to send finances to help them for their Christmas. We pray for South Sudan. And Lord, we would also just pray for North Sudan too, as they seek to open up the country more, Lord, and allow more religions to operate there. We think of the work in Kenya, Lord, and we pray for the gifts that we've sent that will help the Christians there. We know that there are one or two pastors there working, and we pray that you would bless them and encourage them. We pray for the work in Lebanon, particularly in the city of Beirut, where they had the dreadful explosion. Lord, we pray that you would just bless that ministry, that, Lord, you would help them as they seek both to help the people and residents of Beirut, but also in the refugee camps. Lord, we thank you for that work and that ministry. And we just pray that you would bless all those involved with these various works. May we just ask your blessing upon them all. Amen.
Amen.
And we're going to have another song now, and then I'm going to have one or two more prayers, more for the local area. Okay, so shall we have our next song, please?
Would you have a prayer?
And
I'm
quite
asked.
Before I start to close, do you have a prayer? I believe most of you are sitting close to your friends.
Und ich glaube, die meisten von euch sitzen nah bei ihren Freunden.
Just am I right?
Ist das richtig?
Okay. So if you sit close to your friend,
wenn du nah bei deinem Freund sitzt,
then you can tell your friend everything about you.
Dann kannst du deinem Freund alles über dich erzählen.
And so Jesus is our friend.
Und Jesus ist unser Freund.
What a friend we have in Jesus.
Was für ein Freund haben wir in Jesus.
We can take everything to him because he cares for us.
Wir können alles zu ihm bringen, denn er sorgt sich um uns.
Jesus has a song, what a friend we have in Jesus.
Begleitet uns in das Lied, welcher Freund ist unser Jesus.
Thank you.
That was the Vision Choir, which was very nice, I thought, nice rendering. It's good to remind ourselves, isn't it, that there are Christians all over the world praising God, uplifting his name. We're having another little prayer time before I hand over to David. What a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear. And how it reminds us to take everything to God in prayer. So shall we just have another little prayer session? Thinking more of our local area. Father, we come before you once again. We thank you that we have such a friend in Jesus. And we can take everything to him in prayer. We do pray for any who are unwell, or we know people who are unwell at this time with different problems. We come alongside them and strengthen them. We do pray, Lord, for the work of our local street pastors. We do pray for that ministry, that you would just be with them, Lord, and bless them and encourage them. Not easy to go out in the evenings when it's wet and damp and cold, but we thank you that they can remain focused and they are determined to carry on and go around and minister to people wherever they can and help them. We pray for their work of crossings too, helping those with homeless difficulties, that you would bless that work as well. We pray for the work in our universities, Lord, that you would bless those who seek to help and point people in the direction of the Christian faith. We do pray for the work amongst the sailors. Just bless that ministry as well. And we pray for the work in the open air, that you would encourage those who go forth to proclaim your message quite clearly and openly. Father, we pray locally for our rest homes, that though we cannot visit, that the things we've been able to do have helped them. And we pray for the home in Bournemouth with those with learning difficulties. We thank you for that ministry there and pray that you will bless that work as they seek to help those people who need so much help. So Father, we just thank you. We thank you that during this time we can press on regardless. Help us not to be fearful, but to trust and put our faith firmly in the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, all people are fearful at times, but Lord, we have to press on regardless of fear because we serve the Lord Jesus. We thank you that David and Sue have come up from Bournemouth today to be with us. We pray you'll bless David now as he comes and speaks to us this morning. We thank you for the message you have laid on his heart. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
I'll hand over to David now.
Great, thank you, Colin. It feels a bit like an international morning, doesn't it? With those, so I ought to greet you. Sadi kapin on kirak tinglai. Gaiyindi ma titi ma. Sorry, that's just me boasting. If you have a Bible, would you please turn to John's Gospel? And by the way, that was Thai, in case you hadn't, if you hadn't quite mastered the technique. Let's look at John's Gospel, chapter 1, and we'll read from verse 15. And it's really an account of the ministry at the beginning, the ministry of John the Baptist. And we'll see why we're going to look and focus around John this morning. So from verse 15, John testified concerning Jesus and cried out saying, "This is the one about whom I said, 'He who comes after me has surpassed me, for he is greater than I was, and than I am. He was before me. And of his fullness we have all received grace in place of grace.'" Now go down to chapter verse 19. Now, this was John's testimony when the Jewish leaders in Jerusalem came to visit him. And the Levites were there asking him who he was. He didn't fail to confess, but he confessed freely, "I am not the Messiah." Well, I asked him then, who are you? Are you Elijah? He said, no, I'm not. Well, are you the prophet? And he answered, no. Finally, they said, well, who are you? Give us an answer to take back to those who sent us. What do you say about yourself? John replied in the words of Isaiah the prophet, I am the voice of one calling in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord. Now the Pharisees who had been sent questioned him, why then do you baptize if you're not the Messiah or Elijah or one of the prophets? I baptize with water, John replied, but among you stands one you do not know. Here's the one whose sandals I am unworthy to untie. This all happened at Bethany on the other side of the Jordan where John was baptizing. The next day, John saw Jesus coming towards him and said, look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is the one I meant when I said, a man who comes after me surpasses me because he was before me. I myself did not know him, but the reason I came baptizing with water was that he might be the one revealed to Israel. Then John gave testimony. I saw the Spirit come down from heaven like a dove and remain on him. And I myself didn't know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water told me, the man on whom you see the Spirit come down and remain, that's the one who will baptize with the Holy Spirit. And says John, I have seen and I testify that this is God's chosen one. So let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your word this morning. Thank you too, Lord, as we've listened to people around the world singing your praise, we can unite our hearts to praise you as we come to your word to ask that the one who promises the Holy Spirit will give us that Spirit now to help us understand, to engage with you, to meet with you, to hear the voice of the Lord speaking through your word, through me, and as we listen carefully. Help us, Lord, yes, to be focused not on anything else but you, your word, and upon the one who is enthroned in glory, the Lord Jesus. So hear our prayer, Lord, and open your word to us now, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm sure you've just had enough preachers saying, isn't lockdown, isn't the pandemic terrible, and we're all in challenging moments, and so on and so forth. So having said that, I want to try to help you see that as we come to this season of Advent, and as we come, and I want particularly to emphasize the one who led in the Advent, that's John the Baptist, the way in which God particularly works in difficult, adverse, unorthodox circumstances. And we might feel that somehow we've just gone through a terrible year and it's imposed on us all kinds of restrictions. And that is true, and I don't want to minimize that. But I also understand from the scriptures how again and again God works through unorthodox ways, in unorthodox ways, and in challenging circumstances. And the truth is that just as at the time of Advent, the nation of Israel was in turmoil, there was a buzz, there were expectations, there were hopes, God breaks in a most remarkable way. And it begins with a most remarkable man, a most unorthodox man, and that's the way that God works. He doesn't work to our prescriptions, our stereotypes of the way in which we imagine God to be working or to work, or we expect him to work. He breaks in most unusual ways. And it is in those unusual ways, if we got our eyes open, as John says, look, I saw. then we will encounter the God who is working in grace and power for his honour and glory and for our salvation. So we're going to look at John, because I guess if I were to ask you this morning, tell me the Christmas story, you'd be able to recite Gabriel, angels, Mary's. You'd be able to tell me all about shepherds. You'd be able to tell me all about Simeon in the temple. You'd be able to tell me about wise men. And you've got wonderful stereotypes. Is that right? How many of you would come up with, well, let's talk about John. He never figures in the story. There's no nativity play I've ever seen where John figures. Now, I may be wrong, but I want to draw your attention to a man, an unorthodox man, a man that God used powerfully. And why did God do that? Because he found a man, he brought a man who was available to him in a most unorthodox way. In fact, the whole Christmas story is one of orthodoxy, unorthodoxy, isn't it? I mean, you know that shepherds, who were the first of the lay people to hear the news, shepherds were, they were marginalized people, they were no people. They were people out in the margins of society. They weren't allowed ever to give testimony in court. They were the kind of riffraff on the margins. And yet, God says, actually, they're the kind of people I want to hear first, the good news of a Savior who is Christ the Lord. So let's look at John with you, if you would, with me. The man that God has chosen, the person that God looks for, a person who Jesus says is a model. That's why he's important to us, because Jesus says, I want to tell you something, of all the people born of a woman, there is none greater than John the Baptist. And you think, well, that's beyond me. But then Jesus goes on to say, yeah, but he who is least in the kingdom will be greater. So it's opened the way for us. If we look at the life of John, we'll see how John's life can be a model for us to be effective, to be a person that God can use where we are to change things and to bring honor and glory to him. And John is unique. You should read his birth, the narrative of his birth. His dad goes into the temple. It's his turn. And God speaks to him and says, well, Zechariah, you're going to have a son, and he's going to be great. He's going to be born great. He's going to be filled with the Spirit even from his birth. And he's going to be great, and he's going to turn the hearts of people to the Lord. And Zechariah says, yeah, well, how's that? That's not possible. You haven't seen my wife recently. She's beyond it. And the poor man, for his doubt, goes away out of that temple, can't speak for the complete duration of the 9 months of his wife's pregnancy. And John is born, a most unusual birth. Elderly parents godly, yes, lovers of the Lord, yet struggling with doubts and all the rest. And it occurred to me, wouldn't it be amazing? Some of us are here, come into the Zechariah category. How wonderful if God were actually to speak to us this morning and say, I'm going to use you. I'm going to take you and whatever you're doing, and I'm going to make of it something that is going to be great in your circle, in your environment, in your town, in your family. So John comes to us as a man with a unique background. And you're going to say to me, well, he was unique. Fancy his mum and dad, you know, in their late 80s, having kids. That's not us. But let me tell you something. You are a unique person. God made you in his own image. He made you unique. So the psalmist says, I was wonderfully created in my mother's womb. And if you think, well, that isn't me, well, let me tell you this. If you look at the people that God has used, take Jeremiah. God says to Jeremiah, even before you were formed, while you were in your mother's womb, I saw you, I knew you, and now I'm appointing you. Friend, you are someone special that God has created, through whom he has been and will go on working to touch the lives of others. I hope you get hold of that this morning, that you're not just another person in a queue at Tesco's who can't see through his glasses because they're steamed up. You're someone different, special, because God made you, and when he made you, he saw you, and he saw what you could be, and he saw what he could make of you. So here's John coming to us as somebody unusual. Yes, because he is made and called by the living God himself. And John is introduced in the beginning of the gospel that we've just read. There was a man named John, sent by God. It's as simple as that. And you should think of yourselves as someone with a name known to God, called by God, and sent. Doesn't matter where you are, what you're doing, where you go, you could be there as someone sent by God. Sue and I were walking down the Toft zigzag, just from the flat, and we'd been down on the beach, and we were walking back up, and with due respect to my age, Sue said, "Let's sit down, how kind of her." And we sat chatting, and people went by and sort of waved and chatted. And a Chinese lady came by, and don't ask me how, but she stopped, and we started to chat. And we talked, and yes, she came from Malaysia. Yeah, we knew Malaysia very well. Our kids went to school in Malaysia. And the chat developed. She said, "I'm a Christian." And then she told us something of her story. And we got people walking past us up and down the zigzag at the same time. And then she says, "Could you pray for me?" And I thought, well, yes, when we get home. And she said, "No, now, here." So we stopped to pray as people walked past on the zigzag. My friend, you never know when God is going to ask you to do something in a queue, on the beach, in Tesco's, wherever. That's John. That's us. His birth. But let's look at the man himself. He was a phenomenal celebrity. I hope you've understood how popular he was. People were flocking out to listen to this man who was preaching repentance. This was a tough man. He was speaking to people who already had been circumcised. They were part of the covenant people. They thought they'd got their faith all together. And John is saying, look, you need to repent. You need to get ready. You need to examine your hearts. You need to think again as to who you are before the Lord Almighty. And he's preaching repentance. And he's popular. He's a celebrity. And I'm not surprised if you think of his lifestyle. Not everybody's lifestyle, but three D's. Desert. He's in a desert. Well, that's the place where people go where the prophets would be, where you need spiritual help. And there are people always looking for spiritual help. Be alert for that. He was in the desert. Have you seen his diet? Not exactly an Atkins diet, is it? Or a diet that's going to promote health. It's locust and wild honey. Now, Sue and I, in our travels around Asia and up in the mountains with tribal people, we've eaten some pretty strange stuff. But to exist on locusts and wild honey, it is no great attraction. Yet there he is. And his dress code? As we got in the car, Sue said, "Why have you got a tie on? You're preaching. You look really terrible in that shirt." As if dress code is a clue to effectiveness. Absolutely not. And he just a camel's coat, unappealing, no fashion model. And yet, that wasn't a problem. In fact, his appearance wasn't the clue, wasn't the key to his effectiveness. It wasn't keeping up with the fashions. It wasn't being with it. It wasn't being cool. It wasn't being connected and having to follow and get the message over in a nice, easy, comfortable, engaging way. He's right there in the desert, camel coat, locust and wild honey, and preaching repentance. This man had a lifestyle that was amazing. But the point was, he was doing it in the power of the Lord. And there was an attractiveness about this man that drew people, not just to him, but to the Lord. But I love his modesty. From verse 19, we read how the religious leaders of the day came out to John and said, well, you know, you're very popular. People are coming to you. We're the guardians of the religious affairs. We're the establishment. We're the way in which we're to worship God. We're the way in which God is to be approached. So tell us, who are you? Now, when somebody comes to me and says, David, tell us your life story, I have to tell you that I'm quite tempted to tell them all the wonderful things I've done. Because that's innately the pride that is in all our human hearts. You know, coming back from Asia, where we were well known, coming to Ringwood, but people didn't know us at all, we had to just get used to being a nobody. And on the whole, that was okay, but not always. Not always. And we do love to edge into a bit of credit for ourselves. But John, who are you? Are you the Christ? Are you the Messiah? Are you the one that we've been waiting for? And he says, absolutely not. By the way, he confesses freely. He's quite happy to talk. He's not sort of embarrassed, oh, well, who am I? Well, I don't know how to put it. He says, he confesses freely, no, I am not the Messiah. I'm not Elijah. I'm not the prophet. So they say, well, who are you? You can feel their tension, can't you, as they ask those questions. Who in the world are you? What are you? Why is it that people are coming to you? And what does John say? I am a voice. I'm just a voice. That's all I am. You don't make a celebrity of the voice, do you? You don't put a voice on a pinnacle. You don't make statues of voices. I am merely a voice. I'm a mouthpiece. I have to say, as I was preparing, I thought of those original records of my parents, those shellacs, with a dog listening to a megaphone. What were they called?
His master's voice.
That's exactly what John is saying. I am HMV. I'm just a voice. Because the one I'm speaking about is superior to me in every way. He surpasses me. I'm not even worthy to undo his sandals. Now, I want to underline that because the one job a slave was excused from, never ever had to do, was to undo the sandals of his master. Never ever. And John says, the one I've come to proclaim is so great, so superior, so before me, so supreme, that I'm not even worthy to undo his sandals, his feet. My friends, as we approach Christmas, how do we approach the throne, the crown, the manger, the Lord who sits enthroned, the coming King of Kings and Lord of Lords? I remember reading how John Stott, writing of the culture of his day, the late 80s and early 90s, that we saunter into God's presence. And we have lost something of that sense of awe and amazement and breathtaking, staggering sense of astonishment that the King of Glory has entered our world. It's almost as if, I forget I think the founder of Soul Survivor, speaking of the teenage rush towards Jesus, we've degenerated in almost thinking of Jesus as your boyfriend. But he's not. He is the majestic King of Glory. So John, in his protestations, insists that he is not the one and never will be. I know that confessions are good for the soul. Sue and I, when a few years ago were living in Singapore, we'd gone on holiday with our family to an island just off Malaysia. And so there were Sue and I and our three children. Probably they were early teens at that stage. And we were staying in a lovely tropical campsite, single building, thatched roof, all five of us in the one hut, their house, chalet, by the sea, beautiful. It was tropicals, it was warm, it was lovely. And the owner was Mrs. Wong, a wonderfully fierce Chinese lady, who came rushing over as we were settling in and said, "May I have your passports? I need to check you in." And she looked through them, and Matthew Pickard, Naomi Pickard, Sarah Pickard, Dr. S. Pickard, D. Pickard. And she handed them back to me and said, "There you are, Dr. Pickard. All is well." And I just said, "Wow, this is great." I said, "Thank you very much. That's really, thank you, Mrs. Wong. That's lovely, good, yeah." All, I felt very professional. 2 days later, Mrs. Wong came hurrying over in a panic and said, "Dr. Pickard, one of the campers here is not well. Can you come and help?" Well, now I'm rumbled. So this is confession time. I said to Mrs. Wong, "Yes, of course. Look, I'm a bit busy with the kids, but," pointing to Sue, "I'll send my assistant." "I'm not the Messiah. I'm not Elijah. I'm not the prophet." Here's a man filled with the Holy Spirit, on fire for God, and yet says, "I am merely a voice. I'm merely a voice." Here's a man in his modesty, when he's been baptizing, and then Jesus and his disciples are baptizing, and the crowds are shifting away from John to Jesus, and his congregation is dwindling, and his followers are going down in numbers. And they say to him, "John, you're losing your congregation, man. What are you going to do about it? Look, it's not good." And I'm hearing, by the way, during this pandemic, that although we've been, hooray, we're online, and isn't it marvelous? We're seeing lots of people from all around the world signing up. I'm also hearing another voice saying, "Actually, we're not sure people are going to come back when we get to normality." That's why it's so fabulous to see you guys here and doing so brilliantly well in your desire to worship the Lord. But there are whispers. My son-in-law in Winchester, as the vicar in Christchurch there, he's saying we have concerns that we think there will be people who will, having come out of in-person worship, won't come back. Same at Lansdowne. Now John, so I can see people worried, but John says that fine, my disciples are moving over. That's brilliant. And I'll tell you why, says John. Because he must increase. He must be greater, and I must decrease. Isn't that a motto for a principle for ministry? If you're leading a service, if you're doing the sound system, if you're handing out hymn books, if you're welcoming people, what a wonderful, or if you're preaching, isn't what a wonderful principle as you meet people to say to yourself, "He must increase and I must decrease." Here's a man that God could use powerfully. Why? because God had freedom through him to honour the Son, which is what God always does. So here's a man whose lifestyle is unusual, unorthodox, but powered by God. In fact, so empowered was John that Jesus could say of him, John was a burning and a shining light. Are you? Am I? Is there a radiance about us? Is there an appeal and an attractiveness about our persona, our sense in which God, living in us by the power of the Holy Spirit, is touching other people, that is drawing other people, that enables us to connect with other people in a natural way, to pray with people on the toft zigzag? Don't know how that happened, but all I know is that God is able to put us to people and places if we're willing, looking, if we're not preoccupied with the wrong things, that he can connect us to people. What's the third thing about John, and perhaps this is the most important, of course, was his message. The message of John was unequivocal, clear, and if I may say, Colin, focused very specifically. And Jesus says this: John spoke the truth. He had a commitment to the truth. He had an ambition to speak only the truth. I'm having a real problem seeing my notes, so I'm going to try and just pick up on that. He spoke the truth, Jesus says, and you responded to that. Don't worry, that's fine. Thank you very much, Tim. He spoke the truth. He was a witness to the truth. And I'll tell you what that cost him. It cost him his life. It cost him his life. Speaking the truth always, all the time, cost him his life when he denounced Herod for Herod's marriage. Yeah, that's what it can take to be truthful all the time and committed to truth. Are you? Am I? Friends, we live in an era of fake news, of nuance, of embellishment, of half-truths. I want to tell you that speaking the truth in love is what God expects of us. Commitment to the truth. And John was very committed to the truth. Well, let me just... I want to find one other emphasis on that if I can. Truthful. He was actually utterly truthful for God. Here's the verse. It was chapter 5, verse 38. Jesus said, "You have sent to John, and he has testified to the truth." Constantly, all the time. Make sure you are a person who is committed to the truth. As a result, as I said, he lost his life. His commitment to the truth cost him his life. Secondly, he was centered on Christ. He spoke of Christ. He urged people, stop looking in the wrong place. And we do. When we've got a fixed view of things, we only see that perspective, don't we? You think of Peter at Joppa, at the house of Simon the Tanner. And he's given a vision from the Lord that is going to lead to the embrace of the Gentiles into the gospel. And he doesn't get it. And let me tell you, when we have fixed ideas as to how things should be, it's very hard to shift them. It is more difficult to unlearn what you've been taught than it is to learn something new. So we have to keep asking ourselves. That's why John keeps saying, look! He said it twice. Look, open your eyes. Do you see? How many times does Jesus in the Bible to his disciples say, open your eyes. Look. Have you not seen? Can't you see? Ask the Lord to baptize your eyes. That's the message. And John points people to Jesus. In fact, when we were in Thailand and we used to preach, and many Thai Buddhists would say to us, yeah, Jesus is great. He's a great teacher. We appreciate his teacher. He's a great moral liver. He's an upright man. But that's not enough. And John zeroes in on three critical things about Jesus and makes it very, very clear. Three important statements about Jesus. First of all, he is God himself made in flesh. He is God's son, as we just read at the end of the reading, verse 34. This is, I have seen and I testify. Seeing and relating that to what he's been taught. I have seen, experience, and testify that this is God's chosen one, the Son of God. He's divine. He's the gift of God. He's the provision of God. He's the one who has come down from heaven, who existed before creation, whose sandals I'm unworthy to untie, and he's the one that God has brought into the world. This is God amongst us. And I can tell you, you can say all sorts of things about Jesus and you'll get nods and people saying, well, but there'll come a point when you start to say, this is God's son. He is God. He is God in flesh. He is the real, divine, empowered God on earth. And you'll find that Muslims will turn away. You'll find that Buddhists will say, there is no God, so what's so special about Jesus? It will be the stumbling. But John is very adamant. He is divine. I have seen and testified that he is God's chosen one. And he emphasizes that when he says this, the one who sent me to baptize with water told me that he will baptize with the Holy Spirit. And only God can do that. Every listener, then listening to John, knew exactly what he was saying. Only God can pour out his Spirit. Only God can baptize a person in the Spirit, can make them new, can regenerate, can create a new person. And when John says, I heard God say, this one on whom the Spirit descends, that is the one who will baptize in the Holy Spirit. That's the proof he is the divine Savior. And then, of course, we have those wonderful words that John repeats. Look, behold, see the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. He's not only the Son of God, he is the Savior of the world. And the Lord Jesus brought this out himself. The Son of Man didn't come to be served, but he came to serve. He came to seek and to save that which was lost. He's the Savior who came. He is the Lamb of God. He's God's Lamb, not ours. He's not the one that we imprison in our own imagination. He is God's provision, God's sacrifice, God's saving Savior, if you like, to bring us back to him. And then, of course, the other S, if you're looking, is that he is supreme. I've already said it, but John never loses sight of the supremacy of the one who came in lowliness, but one day will return in power and glory and in triumph and in honor and praise and worship, before whom every knee will bow and every tongue confess. Jesus Christ is God, is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. So was John perfect? Is he a role model beyond our reach? Well, he had his lockdown literally in a prison cell, as you remember. His faith cost him. It cost him his freedom, it cost him his ministry, it cost him ultimately his life. And there in prison, he asks a question of those friends who are still connected. He said of Jesus, is he the one? or should we look for another? So John has his doubts in lockdown too. I hope you'll hear the answer clearly and loudly. It's interesting, God doesn't say, yep, he definitely is. And I can tell you, we're all asking questions, what's going on in lockdown? What's going on with the pandemic? What's God doing? And we're expecting God to spell it out in 1, 2, 3 words. And he's going to say, look around, use your mind, use your praying, think about it, think about the scriptures, the way in which I, the Lord God Almighty, work, the freedom by which I intervene, the unorthodox ways in which I call people, Moses in a burning bush, Isaiah in a temple where he's been hundreds of times, but that time he left that service a different man. Think again. And here's the answer Jesus gave those friends to take back to John. Look, you've been saying. Well, look and listen, John. The blind see, the lame walk, the deaf hear, the poor hear good news preached to them. Happy are those who are not ashamed of me. Friends, it's time to stop asking questions of God. What are you doing? Tell us what to do. Should we do something else? Do we need to look for another? Have we been... Just see as God works in our world right now and ask him to give you the insights and the Spirit, the Holy Spirit-inspired discernment that will help us to live in changed circumstances with an unchanged God who is Lord, who is a Saviour, and who's coming again. John is only preparing the way. There is perhaps something coming that none of us can predict. We never know with God when he will break in. But are we ready? Are we lining up with a John the Baptist? Or are we those that are saying, who are you? What's all this about? Should we look for another? May God help us to wholeheartedly be a John the Baptist for him today. Let's pray. Lord, thank you so much for your word that is there to lift us, to encourage us, and to set us on our way with praise. What a friend we have in Jesus. Not because we know enough about Jesus, but because he's the one who is able to do more than we could ever ask or think. He's the one who's able to lift us and use us. Lord, we want to be humble in our hearts, but faithful and strong in our commitment, and to honor you with all our hearts and minds and soul and strength. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you, David, for those challenging words. We're going to end up with a song. Bless the Lord, O my soul, then I'll close with benediction.
It's time to say
Your loving care during this coming week. Please bless every family represented here, we pray. We pray that you will be with us, you will bless us, guide, lead us and direct us. Now into Jesus comes again. Amen.
Amen. Amen.